Pastor Dean open the doors of this church so that people that are hurting and dying, that need Jesus to open their eyes, to unstop their ears, to drive the cancer out, can find out today He is still the same now that He was then. Give Jesus a great big hand clap all over the auditorium. Come on, give the Lord a great big hand clap on this Thursday night. Praise the Lord. How many of you are ready for the Lord to bless you greatly? I am too. Well, you're in the right place. We have tonight, and then I want to announce right up front that tomorrow I'm going to do something that we used to do in our revival services, which we called it Breakthrough Friday. So we've been teaching in the morning. We'll teach again. But we're going to lay hands on everybody 11 o'clock to noon. So I'm going to teach and minister to everybody that comes. And then at the night, we'll have a blowout service to round out week one. And then give you a little break and go into Sunday through Wednesday just before Christmas and give the devil another good boot to the head. Amen. Yeah. Lift your hands wherever you are. And if you give me a little fuller volume on the, maybe it's just no monitors. Father, thank you for all that you've done. Thank you for who you are, and thank you for those that are here. I pray that you would bless greatly every person in the sound of my voice as they hear your word and receive of the goodness of the Holy Ghost. Thank you for sending us a gift, the gift of the Holy Spirit, and thank you for filling us with his power. In Jesus' name, I pray every issue of concern that anybody came in here with, that they would not leave with it. They would leave with total victory. And you would set a course for us, Father, as we begin to go into this new year called 2020. That whatever the devil's planning, the legs would get cut out from under it before it has a chance to get started. In Jesus' name, we thank you for it. We give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. For it's to you and you alone who it's due. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. Now listen, you young people, I don't know if you want, I like to walk around here, so you're going to have to scoot. Go on, get out, beat it. How many of you are thankful for all the youth that are here in this church? Me too. And I'm thankful for you. You can be comfortably seated. I want you, if you have your Bible, to open it with me. To the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, verse 11. We also pray that you will be strengthened with all his glorious power, so you will have all the endurance and patience you need. May you be filled with joy. Everybody say, filled with joy. Always thanking the Father who has enabled you to share in his inheritance that belongs to his people who live in the light, who rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son, who purchased our freedom and forgave all of our sins. That's a pretty loaded verse. I'm going to read it again. Verse 13. Well, I'll go to 12. Who enabled you to share in the inheritance that belongs to his people who live in the light. For he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred. And if I speed through it again, then you might as well have to just read it a third time because you'll miss it. Say, who rescued us? So Jesus isn't rescuing us, and he's not going to rescue us when the trumpet sounds. Jesus rescued us when he did his work on the cross and then rose again. You've been rescued from the kingdom of darkness. Can you say amen? Amen. And transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son, who purchased, ED, past tense, purchased our freedom. Everybody say, I'm free.
I'm free.
If your freedom's been purchased, then you're free. And forgave our sins. Verse 15, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him, and he existed before anything else. And he holds all creation together. Christ is the head of the church. I won't have you repeat stuff all night, but I want you to say that. Say, Christ is the head of the church. Now, if you got a good coach or manager for a team, then you don't have to worry about that team. That team's in good hands. You know, you take a team, which they're not popular outside of New England, but anybody, if they're fair-minded, would have to say the New England Patriots have had a pretty good run from about when, 1999 or so, up until still going. And there's been one guy at the helm, Bill Belichick, and he does a good job with that team. Even if you don't like him, you wouldn't mind him coaching your team, that's for sure. You ask a Cowboy fan, they say, I hate the Patriots, but if you had the chance to get Bill Belichick as your coach instead of whichever one they're trying out this year before they replace him, you'd be happy to have him because that guy knows how to manage a team. It's almost like an anomaly if they don't make the playoffs. You wonder what's happening rather than be excited when they do. Well, the Bible says Jesus is the head of the church. And so when you have somebody good in charge, you don't have to worry about what's going on the team. And I say that because you have a lot of people that they enjoy worrying. And it's like through 2020, they say, man, look at all these churches that are shut down. I'm very concerned about the state of the church in America. Well, number one, there's no use for you being concerned about it because you can't do anything about it anyway. And then secondly, you never have to be concerned about what's going on in the church because Jesus is the head of the church. And Jesus is a good custodian of his own church. In fact, what happened that you saw through COVID is a lot of the garbage that's gone on under the name of Christianity, it doesn't exist anymore. There's no market for it. Those churches are shut down. They shut down for a year and bowed to fear. Some are still shut down, depending on where you live. And when they open back up, there's 30 or 40 people. Some places had 5,000, and now they have 300. So it's over. They're going to have to sell their building. That's the Lord. The Lord's the head of the church. To he who uses well what he's been given, he'll be given even more and have an abundance. But to he who squanders what he has, even the little he has will be taken away. There's a story in Luke chapter 13 where the master of a garden came and checked on a tree and said, these 3 years, I've come seeking fruit from this tree, but I haven't found any. I'll give it one more year, and if I don't see any fruit, I'll cut it down. So a lot of times people are flying high and they're getting good numbers on YouTube, but they don't realize that it's lasting fruit and truth to the word that matters. There's a lot of things I could preach on here that might draw even a bigger crowd than the great crowd we've had coming. People are interested in weird things, but it's not the Bible. So you might have a nice little 4-year run or 5-year run or 12-year run, but there's a certain type of fruit and activity that lasts. I'm not looking to have a 15-year ministry. I'm not looking to have a 20-year ministry. I'm looking to follow people like Brother Hagin and Brother Summerall, where you're doing more at 78 than you were at 28. Can you say amen? Amen. And so everybody say, Christ is the head. And Jesus will expose things and clear out his whole church. In fact, and I'm not preaching on it tonight, but the way I'm wired, I have to be careful or I will end up preaching on it tonight. But I've had the Lord have me in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 for guidance. And 2 Chronicles chapter 20 can basically be broken into 3 sections. Section 1 is 2020. For me, and I'm not, if you're watching, you're from Bible college or you're a professor, I'm not saying that 2 Chronicles 20 was written to break down the years 2020, 2021, and 2022. But I am saying that the Lord drew my spirit there and showed me what he was doing. 2 Chronicles 20, all of Israel is under attack by enemies. And they say to stand in the temple. So in the first section, people had a decision whether they were going to compromise and go on the enemy's side or whether they were going to stand on the Lord's side. And the people had to make a choice. And some went to the temple and stood with the Lord, and the Lord delivered them. 2020 was basically a litmus test for anybody that's in the ministry, where you had an opportunity to bow to fear of man, fear of a virus, or both. Every church or ministry that shut down didn't do it because they were afraid of the virus. Some would tell you behind closed doors, it's not the virus. I believe in healing, but we got so many negative Facebook comments, and some people got death threats, and so they said we had to shut down. Well, you didn't pass the test. There's tests in Christianity. God doesn't test you with sickness or disease, but there are tests to see who will back down and who will step up. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And they told you during that time that if you kept your church open, Pastor Dean heard it, I heard it, anybody that decided, no, we're going to keep preaching the gospel and ministering to people, they had people tell them, well, if you do that, A, you're going to have a lot of people get sick and die, and then B, your church is going to empty out. People are going to see that you're a lunatic, and you're going to lose your whole ministry. But it actually went the other way. Now, I'm not just talking about this church. You look at Dr. Rodney Howard Brown, you look at him, I know for my Uncle Ted, that not only kept preaching, but kept putting his tent up the whole time. And I mean, getting outdoor permits during COVID, that was no easy task. Well, their ministries aren't down to a handful of lunatics who also agreed that they were doing the wrong thing, but we might as well stick it out. The ministries that stood with God, we have other pastors that are here that did the same thing. Their ministries grew people-wise, grew financially, because you never go down standing with Jesus. Can you say amen? Amen. I don't know why everybody's looking at me like their favorite pet died just before church, but I'll fight through it, I guess. You never go down standing with Jesus. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And then, so that was 2020. Well, there's the second part of 2 Chronicles chapter 20. After they stood with the Lord judged their enemies. And that's what you've seen. Different governors. In fact, since I've got to New Mexico and a few days before, you've had mass resignations of all kinds of people that were against the church, whether they're in government, whether they're in the media, that they're all going missing. They're all deciding to step down. And there's more of that to come, because anybody that touches the church leashes judgment on themselves. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not stand against it. Can you say amen? So that's what you had this year. And I prophesied that in January of 2021 because of what the Lord drew me to in 2 Chronicles 20. That 2020, the Bible says judgment must first begin in the house of God. So 2020, what was judgment? And not God killing people, but it was God seeing who's going to stand with me and who's going to stand with the enemies of the church. Then once that happened, there's judgment in the world against those that came against the church. The only reason Jesus hasn't returned yet is so people have time to be saved. So anybody that tries to stand against the preaching of the gospel and the salvation of man, they're actually opposing God directly. Can you say amen? Well, then you got the third part, which is what 2022 is going to be, where they not only were the enemies judged, but all their equipment and wealth was left. And at the end of that chapter, the Bible says the children of God came and spent 3 days gathering up all the spoil of equipment, clothing, and valuables, more than they could hold. 2022 is a year of accelerated harvest, where now it's time that the thing the devil tried to hold back is going to come in overflow. An overflow of souls, an overflow of finances, an overflow of open doors, an overflow of opportunities. That's what we're stepping into right now, and you ought to be happy, because this year's not going to be a year of struggle for the child of God. This is a year of victory for all those that stand with Jesus. And if you stand with Jesus tonight, let him hear your hand clap. Clap your hands in New Mexico and let him know you're on the Lord's side. Somebody say, I'm on the Lord's side. And I feel that for America. I also feel, even though it looks contrary in the natural, I also feel that the Lord that will run the nations again and preach the gospel. I don't believe I'm going to carry out the rest of my ministry shut out of different nations. And well, you say, well, you can get vaccinated. I'm not getting vaccinated. So, and the Lord knows that. And I'm going to go preach overseas again whenever that clears out. Now, you need to keep some people in prayer. Where my sister pastors, they just passed a law. When I say a law, there's no constitution. See, America, I was telling the guys when we were driving over, we have two things that are majorly in our favor. And again, I have a hard time talking about this shortly, but it is really amazing that the U.S. Constitution has been such a thorn in the side of the Antichrist spirit. Now, if you're secular, and now I hear a lot of Christians, even they call them globalists or Illuminati. The Bible calls it the Antichrist spirit that wants to bring everything under a one world government, one world religion, no national boundaries, and one world military, and that no man can buy or sell unless they receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead. Can you say amen? Amen. Good to see you, my favorite, one of my favorite couples here in New Mexico. Glad to see you again, brother. Congratulations on the wedding and everything. Love you so much. So, they're my friends. So, one of the things that's made it very difficult on that Antichrist spirit is the way the American government's drawn up. Because the other governments are top down. So in Canada, Justin Trudeau can just get on Facebook Live and announce we're going to do this, this, and this. And everybody has to listen. Can't challenge it. You can do that in Europe. So Europe is basically, you elect a prime minister, but then he goes to the meeting of the European Union and other people say what they've decided. And then you as the prime minister just come back and tell everybody what's going to happen. There's almost no point of even having a house of representatives or anything. But the way they drew up America, which was spiritual, because these 13 colonies hated each other. They didn't get along at all. They had different interests. And Ben Franklin, when they met to draft the Constitution, said no one's allowed to eat until we get this thing written up and get our problem solved. That's called fasting. Even if you did it by accident, it's called fasting. And then B, he said, before we start talking again, we're not just going to argue. We're going to take time and pray. That's called prayer. So it began in Philadelphia there with fasting and prayer. And after they finished that time of prayer, everybody went from arguing to coming to an agreement. And they drafted up that document that God had his hand on called the Constitution. Now, my sister pastors, like I said, in Canada, they just announced in her province that beginning Monday, all houses of worship have to have a vaccine passport. And so if you're not vaccinated, you cannot come to church. Well, my brother-in-law is not vaccinated. My sister's not vaccinated. And they've taken a stand like we have. And they need supernatural help. And there's some people, like my friend in the front row and myself, that saw this coming ahead of time. If you said that in March 2020, people called you a lunatic. If you, they're not, come on, bro, they're just saying 15 days to slow the spread. But there are some people that have what's called foresight by the Holy Ghost. And if you study Bible prophecy, then you know there's a push by the Antichrist spirit to cause everybody to, the Bible says that no man will be able to buy or sell without a mark in their right hand or in their forehead. Well, that's not the vaccine, but when you start introducing things that you have to have something injected into you in order to participate in society, now you got a problem. And people couldn't see it. I even tried to tell, but a lot of Europeans can't see it, and a lot of Canadians can't see it. They would do protests, and they would say to the government, make the church essential. Well, even that's a mistake, because you're granting the government a power they don't have. The government doesn't have the power to say whether a church is essential or unessential. Jesus said the church is essential. And I don't know, you know, I don't know New Mexico history. I don't. But there's something in the people here, and I preached in Texas during the whole thing. The New Mexican people have more of what Texans are famous for than they do in Texas. There's a freedom in the people here where I don't know. I don't know where you got it from. I don't know if revivals came through here or what. But people do have a distrust for what they should have a distrust for.
Yeah.
There are not people in Washington, D.C. staying up at night hoping that they can solve your problems.
Yeah.
There are majorly powerful groups. How many of you were here when I preached about Babylon?
Yeah.
That's in the Bible.
Yeah.
It says, you deceive the world through your pharmacies. You traded in human lives. You got rich off of human bodies.
Wow.
Now, if you think, so if people don't see that that's in the Bible, then they call it conspiracy or whatever else.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you, there's no way, unless you're just going to ignore the book of Revelation. The Bible tells you that the devil has a plan, and if you let him, where it will go. And it's not a good plan. So when you hear these people talk about one world, and maybe we should all just come together and unite, it sounds good. But the Bible tells you when that finally takes place, it's not going to bring world peace. It's going to bring the worst 7 years that the world has ever known. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And I was telling another preacher that I've preached on this my whole ministry. And up until 2020, even Christians looked at you like you were nuts. I think you take this a little seriously. You never heard any messages on the rapture. People quit preaching about that. Then if somebody brought up Revelation, some preacher just makes some cockeyed statement about, well, there's a lot of confusing stuff in there. Well, figure it out. That's your job. Stock market's confusing too, but if you're a stockbroker, you don't tell your clients, well, that stuff's confusing. All your money's gone. I can't tell you why. That stuff's confusing. Goes up one day, down 2 days. No. The Bible says study to show yourself approved, and the Bible says labor to preach good doctrine, which means there is good doctrine and that you can have it. Can you say amen? Now, obviously, if you want to start trying to pick the specific day and time that Jesus is coming back, there are a lot of fruity people that have got into Bible prophecy and looked like idiots. But there's fruity people that have gotten into healing and faith and everything else. Just because there's one moron doesn't mean you reject the Bible. You find out what the Bible says, and it gives you the heads up on what's coming down the pike. Everybody say the church. Yeah, the church is not a government organization. The church is actually aligned against wicked governments. And somehow, there's a lot of preachers that believe that the main goal is to be at peace with your city. Turn to Jeremiah, Jeremiah chapter 1. If you're all going to stare at me on that, I might as well just preach hard like a Southern Baptist. Jeremiah 1. Jeremiah, the first chapter. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. The Lord gave me this message. Before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. Why do Christians make such a big deal about abortion? Because your life doesn't actually even begin when you come out of the womb. God knew who you were before you were formed in your mother's womb. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Life matters. People's lives matter. And so, well, these Christians, they stick up for pro-life. They like babies in the womb, then they don't want to help do anything after they're born. Who are you? I fed 1,500 children today out of our ministry, and I'll do it again in the morning. Most of them, the only meal they ever eat. So shut up. I'm tired of the criticisms that are lobbied by demonic people against the church. The church is the most racist place there is. Oh, really? I believe it was Charles Darwin that if you read his writings, evolution that they teach you in public school. Bring it up to your biology teacher. Yeah. I'm not making this up. Evolution was the one that said that black people are a lower species than white people. The Bible doesn't say that. Science says that. The Bible says, who abolished slavery? For all the people that say that Christians were slave owners, who abolished slavery? A Christian who was a slave trader that was doing his devotions, and all of a sudden God gripped his heart and said, these are men created in my image. John Wilberforce, look him up. And he ended it. All these people talking about slavery. There's 10 times more people put in slavery by Islam, and they're still doing it right now. The World Cup stadiums in Qatar are all being built by black slave labor. Yeah, nobody wants to do anything about that, though, because you'd actually have to do something. You're going to just talk about what happened a long time. You hate slavery so much. What are you doing about the World Cup? You're buying a ticket and selling T-shirts. That's what you're doing. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Don't tell me I'm racist. Look at this meeting. Is there a Hispanic section and a white section and a black section? Do they turn you away if you're not white? These white evangelicals. You find me a white church. You can't find them. I preached in Finland, capital of white people. Santa Claus has a summer home there. And it started out mostly white. And I stayed there and preached a week. And we had a bunch of Nigerians get saved. A bunch of Syrian immigrants came and heard and got saved. They started inviting their friends. By the end, that place looked like the United Nations. Because Jesus is not a white man's God. He's not a black man's God. He's not a Mexican's God. He is the Lamb that was slain for every tongue, every tribe, every nation, and every race. So tell your woke teacher at community college that the Bible's the book that ended that whole thing. Because the Bible says from one blood, Acts chapter 17. Everybody say one blood. From one blood he created all the nations. And Christians were the ones that said, no, people are not. Some lesser and some more. Men were created in the image of God. Women were created in the image of God. And they're to be treated with dignity. You know, while I'm on the thing, I'll just slam this devil's head into the dresser drawers a couple more times. Because the next thing, turn to 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'll get back to Jeremiah. 1 Timothy 4. First Timothy 4:1. Now the Holy Spirit tells us clearly that in the last days, what days are we in right now? How do you know you're in the last days? Because when Peter received the baptism of the Holy Ghost in Acts chapter 2, when he came forward to explain what's happening, he said, these people aren't drunk like you suppose. This is the fulfillment of what the prophet Joel said, that in the last days. So if the baptism of the Holy Ghost being poured out in Acts chapter 2, almost 2,000 years ago, began the last days, then we're not only in the last days, we're in the final moments of the last days. Can you say amen? We're in the final moments of the last days. And I can't tell you clearly enough, if I was you, and I'm not you, but if I was you and I was sitting in that seat, I'd make up my mind to do what I did when I was the one sitting in the seat and what I've recovenanted with God every day to do. I'm going to live ready for the coming of the Lord. I'm not going to allow all the noise and confusion of the media and whatever's being taught to me to make me waver one inch. I'm going to be a Book of Acts Christian from now until when Jesus comes and the devil can't do anything about it. Now the Holy Spirit tells us clearly that in the last days, many will depart from the faith. They will follow deceptive spirits and teachings that come from demons. That's an interesting scripture. Say with me, teachings that come from demons. You know, if you're already considered an extremist, which I am, then you might as well just not guard your speech. Why are there people starving to death in India when they have cows walking around everywhere? Because there's a teaching in that religion that comes from demons that cow is more valuable than you. So people starve to death and die while they have food that God created them to eat standing right there. Can you say amen? Amen. Teachings that come from demons. What's abortion? Teachings that come from demons. In the last days, people depart from the faith and follow teachings that come from demons. When you tell a six-year-old boy that if he feels like a girl, he's actually a girl trapped in a human body. That's not like we don't believe that because we're Christians and though science teaches that, we believe the Bible. Science tells you. It's not your midsection that determines your sex. Your sex is determined XX or XY. And every cell of your body is either male or female. Women don't even have the same skin. There's female skin and male skin. That's why a guy can get all dressed up in makeup and high heels and get breast implants. And you look at it, Simon. Now, I got a question for you. Where did that come from? In the last days, people follow teachings that come from demons. And the Bible, listen to me now, because I'm not just making like bashing stuff. I want you to know how close you're living to the return of Christ.
Come on.
I'm not old, I'm 41. When I was in school, 1998, my senior year of high school, if you'd have said that the day will come where you have to allow your child, that they're going to give state-funded, covered by state health care, they're going to give puberty blockers and hormone therapies to six-year-olds to give them different genitals and a different sex, they'd have told you you're nuts. Southern Baptist fire and brimstone preachers would have told you you're crazy. That's not going to happen. Come on, there are limitations. Do you know the devil will never set the bar on something being too wicked? The devil's never going to say, no, I think that's enough. So what happened? You had the push for gay marriage, and finally the church backed down. Okay, we're not going to make a big deal about that. What'd you think? The devil, okay, then we're good. No. Then it goes to transgender children. Then it goes to multi-person unions. Then it goes to court cases that are being had where people can marry their pets. It's a double word the Bible uses called sexual immorality and sexual perversion. And the Bible says in Revelation 20, let me tell you again, that no one who practices sexual immorality will enter the kingdom of heaven. And I'm telling you, America, if you bring a preacher here, which I have, if you bring a preacher here from India or Africa or some other country, they look at the billboards with half naked and they go, what's that? Well, you guys, you have sex everywhere. What's with this? This is crazy. It would be illegal to put that billboard up. Got a lady, making people wreck with huge Photoshop boobs on the thing. Everything sex and sex. And then the afternoon talk shows. I identify as pansexual. I identify. And they're constantly using the television to pump what the Bible calls teachings that come from demons. Because what they'll never show you is many of those children that at 6 and 7 decided that they want to be a different gender. If you check back up on them at 14, they have major regrets. Why did anybody let? But they won't let you talk about that. They might take me off of YouTube right now for talking about it, but I've given my life to tell my generation there is an evil that's in this world, but you don't have to go with that evil. You can live for Jesus Christ by the fire of the Holy Ghost. They just passed a law in Canada. Canada, just a little drive up north. Not Syria, not Pakistan. Canada. I can drive there where my sister is potentially going to be arrested in 2 weeks. I can drive there in 10 hours from my house. So you call me whatever you want. I've had enough. If the devil's had enough of me, these last 20 years, if you arrest my sister, you're going to see a different me. I'll start preaching bare-chested. Grow out a beard and have like a staff. And other Ninja Turtle weapons. This isn't a game. It's not a game. People's lives are on the line. And if one side's pumping darkness and the side that has the light shuts up about it because you can lose your YouTube channel. Let me ask you a question, because what I brought up, Canada passed a law that if somebody is gay, you can't even pray for them as a minister. Because you're rejecting, they call that gay conversion. And they passed an anti-gay conversion law 2 weeks ago. Trying to do the same thing in California right now. In fact, see, if I was in another church, I would do this, but you guys believe me. So I won't do it here. I don't need to convince you. I just watched a video how secretly in a California public school, they helped convince a young student that they're another gender without telling the parents. Gave them the medication without telling the parents, which is hormone therapy, and then announced to the parents what had happened after it was all done. So when they told the parents in the guidance counselor's office, and the parents, what would you do if they told you that? It'd blow your top. So they called Child Protective Services, took the child away, and arrested the parents. Oh yeah, it just happened. And so the mom and dad both came and gave a speech to the school board. I want to tell you, we don't hear no speech from me. And that's why my kid's in private school, not so she gets a good education, to make sure I'm not in a position like that, because there'd be no speech. We're going to force, we might give the vaccine to children. If you try to touch my child, you won't touch my child. Got to be careful what you say on camera, but it will not end with you touching my child. I'll arrange a meeting with you and Jesus. I'm going to tell you something. If you don't get anything out of tonight and these revival meetings, I'll tell you what you're going to get in your spirit tonight. You're going to get a fire in your belly that the devil's not going to have my family, and the devil's not going to have my life. And in case I forget at the end of the service, let me tell you right now, all the stuff I'm telling you is to tell you how real, how the Bible knew this was coming 2,000 years ago. Nobody wanted to listen. Nobody wants to listen now any more than anybody wanted to listen to Noah telling them there's a flood coming. What are you doing building a huge boat? He was in Iraq. He was in Mesopotamia, modern day Iraq or Iran. There's no ocean. It's the desert. And he's not building a canoe. He's not building a 40-foot fishing boat. He's building an ark that's still lodged in a mountain. And the people asked him, what are you doing, you dumb old man? We live in the desert. There's a flood coming. It's going to cover the whole earth. Flood. We don't live anywhere near water. And not one person listened to him the entire time he built that boat. But Noah had a predecessor whose name was Enoch. Enoch was a prophet that walked with God so closely that one day he was not, for God took him. Enoch had a son who was Noah's dad, and his name was, who's the guy with the big long name? Oldest man that ever lived. Lived till he was 969. Methuselah. Noah preceded Noah. Enoch had Noah, or Enoch had Lamech. Who is it? It's Lamech, right? Enoch had Methuselah. Methuselah had Lamech. Lamech had Noah. So Noah had this grandfather who was named by his prophet great-grandfather Methuselah. Why do they have all these short names? Enoch, Lamech, Noah. But then this one guy, Methuselah, because Methuselah was a sentence that the prophet named him. When he comes to his end, it shall come. And if you study the math in Genesis, because it tells you when the people were born, how old their dad was when they were born, the year, and some Bible scholars say within 7 to 8 days of when Methuselah died, the flood came. So though everybody mocked Noah and nothing in the natural looked like it was going to happen, he was not guided by the fact that he lived in a desert or what he could see. He was guided by the prophetic word that his grandfather had released. That when your great-grandfather, that when your grandfather comes to his end, it shall come. And when he died, the flood came just as it did. God never left any generation without a witness. And I'm telling you, and I know your eyes are open. I don't feel any resistance. But I'm telling you, this thing's not a joke. The world can mock. That's all the devil can do. Listen, he can't undo the Bible. He can't stop the power of God. When the baptism of the Holy Ghost came, they mocked. The devil can only mock you and get you to try to feel bad for living a pure life and being married to one wife and raising your children in the fear and admonition of the Lord. But you're going to make up your mind tonight. I will not bow to the Baals of this world. I will live my life for Jesus Christ with or without approval. When 2020 hit with COVID and I did what I did and ended up on international news, I had an older preacher who I like and I'm still friends with him. He said, I just saw you on the news. He said, you need to kind of be careful, don't you think? You got a wife and a daughter. And he said, you can do more for Jesus out of a jail than in a jail. He said, they'll arrest you. See, what he didn't understand and what a lot of people don't understand is my number one job is not to grow my ministry or be an effective minister. My number one job is to do what's right. I'm not a businessman. I'm dressed like one because people receive you better if you're dressed like this than if you're wearing like a one-piece swimsuit or something. But I'm not. And I actually, even though the Lord has given our ministry millions of dollars to steward, none of it has come from making good business decisions. And none of them. It's all come supernaturally from sowing and reaping. My number one goal is not to avoid arrest. Now, you don't want to get arrested foolishly or for sin or for punching somebody in the parking lot because they took your parking space. Or for tax reasons, but you know, that's all filed, all above board. But if it ever comes down, my number one goal, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, yeah. Like Daniel, yeah. Like Paul, yeah. The apostle, like Peter, like all the great men of God that you can read through church history, is to make up my mind, if you ever put me to a test, to deny what the Bible says, to go against the clear teaching of Scripture so that I can keep my life. Or so, we've enjoyed in this country a nice run, and I thank God for it. And that's another reason why it's important to keep it going. That's why all our relatives fought in the military and held off guys like Hitler and Mussolini that were part of that Antichrist spirit. Freedom's important. And because of that, we've been able to enjoy for a long time. Just showing up at church, no persecution, no fines, no anti-conversion laws, nobody driving a bus to the church on Easter Sunday like Pakistan and blowing up 600 of your church members. You go preach over there. I've been there. They got a whole wall with portraits all over of church members that have died for their faith. They were killed by jihadists, hacked to death, died horrible deaths because they made up their mind. They're going to serve Jesus Christ. Northern Kenya. We got people watching us from Kenya right now. The Al-Shabaab Islamic insurgents get on the bus and say, everybody recite the Islamic, whatever you recite to show you're in Islam. And the other guys can't do it. So they have them repeat it. The other Christians repeated it. One on the bus said, I'm not saying it. They said, we'll give you one more chance. And instead he quoted John 3:16 and they cut his head off. And I was in Africa when that happened. And I watched them interview his wife and her. You'd think she'd cry. She had a big smile on her face. Her kids had big smiles on their face. I heard what my husband did, how he wouldn't deny Christ, how he quoted the Bible. We'll see him again in heaven. I'm so proud of my husband. That is real Christianity. It's not I can't come to church because I have a baseball game. It's I've given my life to Jesus Christ. Whatever it costs me, I will not turn back. Sorry, I'm all messed up. But we used to sing, they used to have a single song when I was six. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Second verse, though none go with me, I will follow. Though none go with me, I will follow. Though none go with me. I'm sure Pastor Dean and Pastor Kathy, even though there were people with them, we ended up finding each other over time. They found Dr. Rodney, but it felt like there was nobody with you. Your pastor friends turned on you. Rodney Howard Brown got arrested. You know who turned him in? Another pastor. You know who called the Department of Health and the police on my brother-in-law in Canada? Another pastor that shut down because you make them look bad. They get convicted, and rather than repent, they want you to go away so they don't have to feel bad. So yeah, there is a part of Christianity where you have to take up your cross. Even Jesus, when they arrested him, the disciples were nowhere to be found. They ran and hid. But God is looking in this generation for young men and young women and mothers and fathers and grandfathers and grandmothers that are going to live for Jesus Christ in a world that has turned their back on him. Now the Holy Spirit tells us clearly that in the last days many will depart from the faith. That means people that were in the faith will leave the faith. If you don't lay hands on the sick at your church, but you give, you have your church open to receive a vaccine, your church doesn't do healing meetings, but it gives out the vaccine, that's called departing from the faith. That's not Christianity. Jesus didn't refer people to medical professionals. They brought the sick unto him, and one word and one touch from his hand healed all the sick. There's tons of pastors that'll watch this. They'll watch the whole thing even though they don't want to because they're convicted. They can't turn it off because they know I'm right. And I got the fruit to show I'm right. My ministry's not collapsing. My ministry doesn't have 15% of the crowd that it used to have. Because whatever it costs you up front, the reward of serving God is always priceless. Now, I want you to remember that. There's a reward on this earth, and there's a reward in the life to come. You better stay conscious of that. You get a reward from God here. Blessed are those that are persecuted for my name's sake. You get a blessing while you're here, and you get a blessing. You remember this. One day when it's all over, you're not going to stand before Nancy Pelosi. You're not going to stand before Joe Biden. You're not going to stand before the United Nations. You're not going to stand before the Department of Health. You're going to stand before Jesus with his eyes a flame of fire, and you're going to hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter now into the joy of the Lord." Many will depart from the faith, will turn away from the true faith, and instead they'll follow deceptive spirits and teachings that come from demons. These people are hypocrites and liars, and their consciences are dead. Now, if Paul said that today, he'd lose his minute. Paul, you know, you say a lot of harsh things. It's not that people, even me, people say, "Boy, Jonathan's really strong." I'm not strong. I should be stronger. I'm asking the Lord to make me more strong. People have heard such sissified preaching, weak preaching, that if somebody even halfway tells the truth up front, "Wow, he's really strong." I'm not strong. You're very direct. Do you want me to preach for 4 hours instead of two and kind of like take a lot of time to say what I really, and I think some of you know what I mean. I don't want somebody to go to hell because they didn't catch my analogy I was trying to make the point with. Speak strong. Speak clear. Jesus did. These people are hypocrites and liars. Their consciences are dead. They'll say it's wrong to be married. So according to the Bible, not only is there an attempt to redefine marriage that's from the devil, soon they'll say it's wrong, whether it's for carbon emissions or you having children and overpopulating. They're not going to say there's different definitions of marriage. According to the Bible, they're going to say it's wrong to be married. And it's wrong to eat meat. Well, that's not coming. That's here. Anytime you hear someone, now, I'm not saying everybody that's a vegan's of the devil. Because if you're a vegan, you're not saying, or a vegetarian, you're not saying it's wrong to eat meat. You made a choice not to. But when you hear the International Monetary Fund and the World Economic Forum say that it's wrong in the future, you won't eat meat, you need to stop eating meat. That's not God. That's the devil. It's wrong to eat meat. So the Bible is a major thorn in the side to these people because it already exposes their plan from the beginning. Why do you think, man, we have a problem getting Christians to cooperate with what we're doing? Yeah, because we saw it coming 30 years ago. Can you say amen? They'll say it's wrong to be married and wrong to eat meat. But God created those foods to be eaten with thanksgiving by faithful people who know the truth. Since everything God created is good, we should not reject any of it, but should receive it with thanks, for we know it's made acceptable by the word of God and prayer. That's why you pray before you eat. There's two reasons. One is to thank God for the food, not just dive straight in like a pig. That's what separates you from an animal. You don't just devour. Father, thank you for the food. We realize it came from you. We realize many don't have food. And we've never had to wonder if we can eat, just what to eat. And we thank you for it. And then as you thank God for it, it guarantees that you'll never lack. Complaining causes what you have to run out. Thanksgiving causes what you have to multiply. Jesus took the bread and the fish and he thanked God for it and blessed it, and it began to multiply. Can you say amen? Amen. And then the other thing is to purify or cleanse the food, rather than ask your waitress 50 questions. Where did this chicken come from? Is it a free-range chicken? Can I have a list of this chicken's activities over the last 2 weeks to make sure it was getting proper exercise? Father, bless the food to our bodies. Nourish it to our bodies to your service. We receive it with thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen. There's a reason we operate the way we operate. Turn to Jeremiah chapter 1. Where I had you turn already, and then it was all wasted effort because I had you go somewhere else. Jeremiah 1. The Lord gave me this message. Verse 5. Before you were formed in your mother's womb. Isn't it interesting how everything's spiritual? So, before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. Christians are pro-life because we realize that God, you want to go deeper? Not only did he know Jeremiah in the womb, when did John the Baptist receive the Holy Ghost? In the womb. He received the Holy Ghost in the womb of his mother. Can a clump of cells be baptized in the Holy Ghost? He leaped for joy in the womb. So that's why Christians are pro-life. Now, I'd like to see a list of the amount of people that are anti-you eating meat and pro-life. There'd be none. Do you ever notice people that are against eating meat are also pro-choice? It's a spirit. It's wrong to eat meat. Women should have a right to choose. Israel should give their land back to Palestine. It's the same spirit. Then you notice everybody else pro-life, pro-steak, pro-gun, because it's freedom. What do you need an AR-15 to hunt with? The Second Amendment wasn't given in case the white-tailed deer ever rise up against us. And again, since I've covered as much as I have, might as well just do everything. Well, I mean, come on. You really think you being armed can stop the strongest military on planet Earth from doing something to you if they want to? You'd have to be able to stop nuclear weapons. No. Someone's not going to nuke a country that they want the land and resources from. So let me ask you a question. Was the United States military ever able to successfully stop insurgents in Afghanistan? No. And that was with 10 times less gun ownership than the United States and a 50 times smaller landmass. The fact that if you went into a neighbor, now you watched Marines go into Afghanistan and start getting picked off because a few people had guns. And finally they gave up and left after a few years. And then if you came into a neighborhood in America, wouldn't it be a few people with guns? There's some people, you go to Texas and Louisiana, people have been hoping somebody would invade. You know, 30% of their net worth tied up in ammunition. And that gets me back to what I was telling you before about the Constitution. Because when those men wrote that under prayer and fasting, the first two amendments of that Constitution, that's why my sister and brother-in-law have to have a supernatural intervention. They don't have that in Canada. That A, you have the First Amendment, that the people's right to freely gather and worship God can never be infringed on by the government. That's why every governor that said they're going to shut churches down, if any pastor stood against, they never were able to do anything because the law, and that's why it really irritated me to hear preachers talk about how Christians are supposed to follow the law. The supreme law of the land is not a governor's Facebook Live. The supreme law of the land is the Constitution of the United States. First Amendment, freedom of speech. That the government can't tell a preacher what he can preach. That you can't license speech and make other speech illegal. There's no such thing as hate speech. If you start letting a group of people decide what's allowed to be said and what's not allowed to be said, soon anything that's in here would be hate speech. First Amendment protects it. Why? Because those Ben Franklin and all those guys had just come out from under the King of England, who to be a preacher, you had to be a licensed church and a licensed minister. And if you said anything the king didn't like, they took your license away and you couldn't preach. So they said, here, we're not going to allow the government to silence preachers or silence people from speaking. First Amendment. Second Amendment. That the right of the people to keep and bear. Say that with me. Say keep and bear. Because in Canada, you know, you talk to people in Canada, so, well, we're allowed to own guns. It just has to be in a lockbox, and then their ammunition has to be in a locker on the other side of town. That's not bear. Yeah. That's not going to do you any good. Yeah. Nothing more useless than an unloaded gun. Yeah. Or a preacher that's taken the vaccine. Yeah. Not a person, a preacher. I hear all these preachers. I hope they're watching. I hope they hear me. Well, I got the vaccine so I can travel. What are you going to travel and preach? How to compromise to do what you feel you need to do? You're not worth the plane ticket. Total bums. The right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. You don't allow a government official to stand up and tell you you don't need guns while they have two people behind them with guns. Because basically, America was drafted up that there wouldn't be a ruling class and a servant class. That the people would be on par with the government. Can you say amen?
Amen?
A government of the people, by the people, and for the people. So I was telling the guys when we were driving, A, we have the Constitution working for us, which is why they want to alter it, why they had a plan to pack the Supreme Court and start doing away with different amendments, but it all failed. And that's why when you see us going to fasting and prayer to start the year, we're not having fun. Why is that going on in Canada and not going on here? It's spiritual. If the fire goes out, you ever go camping? The fire goes out, you wake up in the morning where the fire was, there's all kind of bugs crawling around. Nobody invited them. They just move in. If the church or a nation allows the fire to go out, then all of the devil moves in for free. But if the fire stays burning, the bugs can't come in. And the fire that God gave us by the Holy Ghost, it's going to burn bright in New Mexico, in the United States. We're going to see to it. Say it with me. The fire shall never go out. Now make it personal. My fire shall never go out in Jesus' name. Clap those hands and shout one more time under the Most High God. Before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. And I had set you apart and anointed you as a prophet to the nations. Oh, sovereign Lord, I said, I can't speak, for I'm too young. The Lord replied, don't ever say I'm too young, for you must go wherever I send you and say whatever I tell you. And don't be afraid of the people. Again, we were getting a lot of Facebook threats. Don't be afraid of the people, for I will be with you and I will protect you. I, the Lord, have spoken. Then the Lord reached out and touched my mouth and said, look, I have put my words in your mouth. Today I appoint you to stand up against, not stand up for nations and kingdoms.
Jonathan, yeah, I went to hear that preacher. He didn't say one positive thing.
I don't have anything positive to say about demons. I don't have any positive thing to say about people that have sold their soul to a company called Pfizer and are for money going to make sure everybody gets as many doses as possible. What was, somebody look it up on their phone. What raise did the Pfizer CEO take last year? I want to hear it. They act like they're the Salvation Army. Pfizer CEO yearly salary. I want to hear it. Not counting his stock holdings, which are massive. I want you next time you watch television to count how many times this show's sponsored by Pfizer. 21 million he makes. And that company made, somebody tell me what the revenue of Pfizer was last year. I want to hear it. So basically, when you start to have entities that have more money or cash flow than the government they operate in, then they start controlling the government. Yeah. The same way the drug cartels control Mexico. Yeah. So now, what's the difference if your drug cartel's guys that have skull tattoos and teardrops or suits and ties? It's a drug cartel. Yeah. Can you say amen? Amen. Whether you have to go to the corner and buy it from Hector or go to Walgreens and buy it. What's the difference? When people start taking over senators and taking over representatives, and they give all their money to the Republican Party. And that's why the Republican Party stands up against price controls on drugs. You're being ruled by corporations that the Bible calls them Babylon, who controls the people by their pharmacy or their sorcery. That's why every politician, even the ones you think are on your side, they'll say, we don't think there should have to be vaccine mandates. Now, I've been vaccinated. I think everyone should, because they have to say what their guys they take the money from want them to say. I don't have a stance against the vaccine for medical reasons. I have a stance against the vaccine because anytime a group of people think they can control a nation, that's not God. God doesn't work through control. God sets before you life and death, blessing and curse, and says, oh, that you would choose life, that you and your descendants might live. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And I'll tell you another thing. I heard Joe Biden say it with my own ears, and I heard Dr. Fauci say it with my own ears, and I have it saved. We will never mandate vaccines. They said it several times, and then what'd they do? So that, what's that called?
Lying.
What does God say about lying? And what does God say about liars? He hates it. The devil's not called the father of cocaine. The devil's not called the father of adultery. The devil's not called the father of homosexuality. The devil's called the father of
lies.
And when somebody lies, they're of their father, the devil. I don't even trust ministers that have fake Instagram follower numbers. If you'll lie about that, what else will you lie about? You're a liar. You misrepresent yourself. When somebody looks me in the eyes and tells me they're not going to do something, and all along it was a plan to do it, then me and you are not friends anymore. And I'll pray you. These people think they can pray a virus away. I'm going to pray you away is what I'm going to do. And I'll still, you mark this down and remember I said it. I'll be alive and well and preaching the gospel long after every enemy of the church is dead and buried, because I have joined an eternal mission that is backed by God himself. God said, don't you worry about the people, whether it's cartels in Mexico, whether it's high power government rulers in America. I will be with you. Say what I tell you to say. Do what I tell you to do, and I will protect you, saith the Lord. Say this out loud. No man, has a right to determine my destiny.
Hallelujah.
I don't know when, you know, there's no guarantee I'll see you again. Jesus could come back. All kinds of things could happen. So I'll just tell you, they don't have a right to tell you you can't work. Whatever you do for work. That's the Fourth Amendment. They can't restrict a man's right to earn a living. Well, these businesses are non-essential. Who are you? I don't care if you're selling friendship bracelets from 1988. It's essential. If you do it to earn a living, it's essential. Basically, most of what I'm preaching tonight is for people watching on live stream, because New Mexico knows that. You guys have some of the strictest mandates here, and I've been driving around. And no one got the memo. No one checked their email. You guys, and I was here last December. This place was packed. The police were here. And that was the thing I was getting to. Everybody said the Constitution. And then all these other countries I was telling you about are top down. So the prime minister can just tell all the people, you're not allowed to go to the grocery store unless you're vaccinated, and they have to listen. They don't have any recourse. But America's bottom up. We're actually... Essentially, the sheriff here has more power than Joe Biden. The sheriff, if Joe Biden wanted to hold a rally here and the sheriff wouldn't approve it, Joe Biden couldn't come and do a rally. So that's a major thorn in the side to the Antichrist spirit and the globalists looking to carry it out. Because you can't just get Joe Biden on your side and him force everything. You essentially would have to take the country over county by county. And so this nation, now you preach like this, people think you're like preaching American nationalism. I will tell you, there's one domino. Now, if everything's going to come under a one world rule, then you can't have any strong sovereign nations. And there's only one left. Maybe two if you count Brazil, but one that has the really one, and it's America. I've preached overseas. I've preached in many nations. If God called me to China or Taiwan or Congo, where I've preached, or India, where I've preached all over the place, I want to go take trips there and come back. You'd never see me again. I had to go move there. But this nation is worth fighting for. Because if this one falls, it's over. And they thought they had it. And it looked like they had it in March and April of 2020. I was on the phone with Dr. Rodney every day. Is this it? But I know it's not it. Because when that angel came to my room when I was 8 and said, Jonathan, the Lord has reserved you for this last period of time to be an evangelist, to call men and women that are now in darkness into the light, for soon it will be eternally too late. Do you understand? And I said, yes, with my speech impediment. And the angel left, and shortly after, my speech impediment left. And I went to Bible school straight out of high school. And right from graduation the next week, I was going up to Canada to go preach, and haven't stopped yet. Because one day, the trumpet call of God will sound. The dead in Christ will rise. I want you to get a song for me queued up. You can find it on Apple Music. Because it's anointed. And I feel it in my spirit right now, and I can't sing. Look up on Apple Music, Jason Crabb. Midnight cry. One day there's a trumpet that's going to sound. And in that moment, you can't get ready. Bible says it'll be in the twinkling of an eye. It's not enough time to kick your girlfriend out of bed that you haven't married. Or your boyfriend out of bed. Or put a bottle down and go run to a church. Or stop doing whatever you're doing that's sin. The Bible says you must keep watch. And be ready all the time. For in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh. All these signs, the doctrines of devils. The Bible says Satan was cast down to earth in great anger, for he knew his time was short. Where's fentanyl coming from? Killing people. Methamphetamine, all this stuff. Why are so many people dying? Suicides at 14. All this mess. It's the last push of the devil. To take as many people to hell with him as he can. He can't ever go defeat God. He can't overthrow God. So the only thing he can do to get back to him, get back at God, is take the people that he loves the most, you, and deceive them and take them to hell with him. But I'm here in New Mexico to say, whatever his plan is against your life, it's not going to work. You may have lost it in the beginning, but you're going to finish strong. You're going to finish with the victory. You have the ability to play that song? I know this is a little different, but I want to hear it. Go ahead and play it.
Children.
Luke 16:19. I won't make up any words. Just listen. Jesus said there was a certain rich man who was splendidly clothed in purple and fine linen and lived each day in luxury. At his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus who was covered with sores. As Lazarus lay there longing for scraps from the rich man's table, the dogs would come and lick his open sores. Finally, the poor man died and was carried by the angels to sit beside Abraham at the heavenly banquet. The rich man also died and was buried. And he went to the place of the dead. There in torment, he saw Abraham in the far distance with Lazarus at his side. The rich man shouted, "Father Abraham, have some mercy. Send Lazarus over here to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I'm in anguish in these flames." But Abraham said to him, "Son, remember that during your lifetime you had everything you wanted and Lazarus had nothing. So now he's being comforted and you're in anguish. And beside, there's a great chasm separating us. No one can cross over to you from here and no one can cross over to us from there. Then the rich man said, please, Father Abraham, at least send him to my father's home. For I have five brothers, and I want him to warn them about this place so they don't end up in this place of torment. But Abraham said, Moses and the prophets have warned them. Your brothers can read what they wrote anytime they want to. The rich man replied, no, Father Abraham, but if someone is sent to them from the dead, then they'll repent of their sins and turn to God. But Abraham said, if they won't listen to Moses and the prophets, they won't be persuaded, even if somebody rises from the dead. And those words are in red. Jesus said that. And he rose from the dead. That's not a Bible fact. That's a historical fact. I had notes up there that I never got to. I was going to talk about power over the devil, and I was going to talk about the three kinds of spirits that everybody has to face in their lifetime and take dominion over. The Bible says you're a three-part being, spirit, soul, and body. One's the spirit of infirmity that looks to destroy your body. One's the spirit of fear that looks to destroy your mind. And one is what the Bible calls, with a small a, the Antichrist spirit that looks to destroy your spirit in hell. Some people, the devil's got different bait for different fish. Some people it's cocaine. Some people it's alcohol. Some people it's sexual immorality and lust. And what they've done on TV is in the 70s and 80s even and 90s. If people had a problem that way, they knew they were wrong and needed to get free. But these doctrines of devils that the Lord had me preach on tonight, make it work. No, I was actually born that way. I'm an alcoholic. That's who I am. I'm a lesbian. That's who I am. I like having sex with women. You know, I'm a guy. I have sex with women. That's what I do. I'm a man. And instead of seeing it as sin or something the enemy's put to destroy your soul, you accept it as normal. They've lied to this generation, and you don't even hear the word sin. Not just in the world, in church. People have issues and baggage and personality quirks, and they're different, and I'm going through a hard time. It's sin. It's to separate you from God. It's to lull you to sleep. That in this last hour of time, when you should be burning bright, instead you're lukewarm and you miss the rapture. But that's why God sends evangelists to sound the alarm and wake you up and tell you, don't go to hell. Get rid of sin instead of sin getting rid of you. More hell. Now you'll have heard more about hell than most churches will all 52 weeks of next year. There's a hell. Jesus spoke more about hell than he did about heaven. I'm not away from my family preaching for fun. I'm doing it because Jesus died for you. And there's a message that has to go out. I told my daughter a couple weeks ago, I said, you know, I'd love to just be with you all the time. And she said, yeah, but you have to go preach and win souls. You told that angel. She knows. See, if you get your kid filled with all, it's like my dad. My dad would go out to preach. I'd help him pack his truck. I didn't cry. Bye, Dad. Go win souls. Yeah. Then when he came back, tell me about the meetings. I knew what he was doing and was proud, and I knew it was going to be me. I'm telling you, it's worth it. You're worth it. Your family's worth it. If we can get one person pulled out of sin and pull their family out of sin, get their name off of the devil's ledger and say, no, Satan, you're not going to have my family. I'm going to live for Jesus. I told you before, and I wasn't joking, I was prepared to go to prison last year. And if they sent me, I would have carried on doing this until somebody made a call and said, get this guy out of here. This isn't what I do. At some point, it became me.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, John the Baptist is in prison, and he's telling the king that has the power to cut his head off. Hey, king, just so you know, you had your brother killed so you could marry his wife. It's going to send you to hell. Right. I don't care. I'm going to heaven either way. I'm not trying to duck my head and find out what the YouTube terms of service are so I can have a sermon that stays on the air. I'll tell you one thing I know is that God has seen to it through history that this word gets out. So if Facebook, YouTube, and everything else shuts it down, God will raise up a bigger platform to get it out. Because he said, my word will go out. My word will, the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of my God stands forever. And the more pure you preach it, the more of an allegiance God has to your ministry, because your ministry is aligned to his word. It's actually not about you. It's about this book. You're going to take a country over, you got to get rid of this. That's why the same people in California that are trying to legalize pornography for second graders want this book banned. Oh, I can't have this. Yeah. Because the devil knows, if I'm going to spread my doctrine, you can't spread this doctrine. It tells you you weren't created to be messed up. You were created to have dominion. Your body wasn't created to be a slave to Pfizer. It was created to be healed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Your mind wasn't created to be on antidepressants, having to take three pills to get through the day. Your mind was created to have peace and joy and soundness. And your spirit was not created to compromise, to bail. It's created to serve the Lord. And God will give you the power to do it. I said, God will give you the power to do it. You think the devil's the only one that has... The devil's a schmuck. Total toothless punk. I've cast his spirits out in Africa. I've cast them out in India. I've cast them out in Canada. I've cast them out in the Caribbean. I've cast them out in America. It's not even an issue. Say, you think the devil has power to enslave you to cocaine, and God can't give you power to make you have a heartfelt desire to serve the Lord? No. God has more power under his little fingernail than the devil could have if he scraped together everything he had. Can you say amen? Amen. Verse 11, Revelation 20. I saw a great white throne and the one sitting on it. The earth and sky fled from his presence, but they found no place to hide. I saw the dead, both great and small, standing before God's throne, and the books were opened, including the book of life. And the dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead in them, and death and the grave gave up their dead. And they were all judged according to their deeds. Then death and the grave were thrown into the lake of fire. This lake of fire is the second death. And anyone whose name was not found in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. I'm only reading this because, what did I read you in the beginning? Many will depart from the faith. Catholic Church teaches there's no hell. Presbyterian Church teaches there's no hell now. Methodist Church teaches there's no hell. Just like Jehovah's Witnesses. Smith Wigglesworth said, every false religion has two things in common. They teach there's no such thing as sin, and they teach there's no hell. The Pope said, new Pope, Catholic Church for years thought there was hell. Then the new Pope says that souls that aren't right with God just disappear. It's not in the Bible, my friend. Catholic Church didn't build heaven. They don't get to decide who goes. The Assemblies of God didn't build heaven. They don't get to decide who goes. The Methodist Church didn't build heaven. God built heaven, and he tells you how you get in. Anyone whose name was not found recorded in the Lamb's Book of Life, Jesus said he'll say to them, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity, I never knew you. So where are all these Instagram preachers coming from? They all put them in my feed. I've never met them. They pay for their post to be promoted. I mean, you know, you can't never out-sin God's grace. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Who goes to hell then? Any preacher that's trying to get you to be at ease is operating from an unclean spirit. You think I was in my room today before church going, you know what? I want to yell at these people about hell. No, I actually had a different message prepared. But the Lord, when you see the signs that are going on, the Bible says when you see those, don't get afraid. Look up, for your redemption draws nigh. What if this was the last night on planet Earth before that trumpet sound? You think they're going to say, you think on CNN it's going to say we missed the rapture? They're going to say it's some kind of climate event. The earth has purged itself of those that were holding back progress. That's what they're teaching New Age is going to happen. One day the earth will purge itself of everyone that's holding back progress. They're not going to be sad we're gone. They're going to celebrate we're gone. Oh, all those people that were all making a big deal about abortion. Oh, talking about sin, talking about marriage, purity, good riddance. They'll be happy we're gone. They're going to say we missed the rapture. But it's going to take about 3.5 years before the Bible says they'll gnaw on their own tongues for food and beg for death, but it won't come. Because when God's presence withdraws off this earth through the church, the Bible says you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Why do you think they wanted churches closed? If the devil was going to ransack this country, he can't do it with hundreds of people meeting in this house, lifting up Jesus Christ in praise and worship and preaching the word. Final scripture, Revelation chapter 3. Stand on your feet, everybody. Revelation, the 3rd chapter. And the 15th verse. I know all the things you do. That this is Jesus talking. Jesus made a return trip to write this letter to a church. I know all the things you do, that you're neither hot nor cold. I wish you were one or the other. But since you're lukewarm, I will vomit you out of my mouth. I want you to say this out loud. The fire must never go out. And basically, at this point, that's the whole reason I fast and pray to start the year, is just to keep my fire going. I don't have any needs. Got plenty of money in the bank, but I'm going to make sure I don't become somebody that, because now they have money in the bank, gets soft. I said, boy, you should have heard him back in 2020. You know, he's still good. But man, when he was, it's like boxers. If you follow boxing, anybody ever watch, it's not a sin. It's a good thing. Anybody ever watch boxing or MMA? You ever notice when a guy's young and hungry, coming up from the projects, training 18 hours a day, chiseled body, and a different look in his eyes, fighting to get out of the projects. Then he fights different. Then he starts getting a deal with a whiskey company that's named after him. He has his own clothing line. He cuts his first CD or album. I'm old. And then one time he gets in the ring and gets his tail kicked by some other young guy that's hungry. Because he started out a full-time fighter with hunger. And he turned into a rich guy that fought as a hobby. People do that as preachers. And people do it as, it's one of the things I've admired about certain athletes. You know, Michael Jordan, it was like it didn't matter how rich he got and everything. He just wanted to be the best. There's a hockey player named Mario Lemieux, or Sidney Crosby, the place for the Penguins. He's like that. He's won everything. He's 34. He's a multimillionaire. Trains the hardest. Last one off the court. That's my desire as a minister. The fire must never go out. It's nice taking vacations. Nice going out to eat. But there has to be something in here. And not just as a preacher, as a Christian. Because Revelation 3 wasn't written to preachers, it was written to Christians. I would that you be hot or cold, but since you've become like lukewarm water, I'll vomit you out of my mouth. And that would not be a bad description. Not of this church, it would be a bad description, but of the American church. They're not cold, but they're not hot. They don't deny the faith, but you don't see many miracles. It's lukewarm. We promise you'll be out in exactly 90 minutes. You know, when the main draw of your church is popcorn, you got a problem. Now, there's nothing wrong with having popcorn or coffee, but when you start, hey, you can wear jeans. We have popcorn. We have Frisbees. You got a problem. And one of the things, if you're not careful, obviously you didn't sit through a 2-hour sermon because you don't agree with anything. I don't believe in the Bible. You wouldn't even be here. But I'm calling. What did Jesus say would happen to lukewarm? They'd get the same thing the cold get. You better be hot or cold, because if you're 1 foot in and 1 foot out, I'll vomit you out of my mouth. And then he told him, behold, I stand at the door and knock. 5 verses later, verse 20. Open the door and I'll come in. Now be diligent and turn from your indifference. What makes somebody lukewarm? The I word, indifference. Hey, are you coming to revival this week?
Oh, Jonathan's back. Oh, yeah. I come like Tuesday or Friday.
Just, what happened? You're in every meeting. Now, where are you? And I don't know people here, but I hear people talk like behind me or when I'm around people. Anybody seen? And I'm making up names. I don't know hardly anybody here. Anybody seen Deborah?
Oh, yeah, she hasn't, you know, the last 2 months, yeah, she hasn't been coming. They've been having burdens with her marriage. They've been having problems. You know, she started drinking a little bit.
I want you to take stock of your life right now. It's not an issue. It's not something you're going through. It's sin, and it needs to be treated like a member of Al-Qaeda. It needs to be blown off of your life. You need to make up your mind. I'm going to war tonight against every sin, every perversion, every addiction. The devil's not going to have my soul. I make up my mind. I'm going to heaven, and I'm never turning back. I'm going to heaven. I don't know if I've told this story here or not, but when you determine, Pastor Dean and Kathy can't do it. I can't do it. Jesus can't do it. A man has to make up his mind. I'm going to heaven. You'd be amazed what happens when you're determined. People can tell. I was in Boston one time, and I went down a one-way road. There would have been no way I would have been able to back out. And when I got to the end of the one-way street, there was a police barricade with a Boston policeman. And they wear big boots up to here. Guy was probably 6'5", 270. He's a big guy. I am not. And I didn't have a suit on or anything. Well, I couldn't back out. I knew I'd get in an accident because I can't back out through a curvy road. I got out of my car with my shoulders back, and I took the barricade and moved it to the side. And as I was moving it, the cop went, "Hey, what are you doing?" I went, "I'm moving this barricade." It's called authority. One time I was driving from East London, South Africa to Port Elizabeth, South Africa, which was very difficult for me because you drive on the left, which I'd never done. And you're sitting on the opposite side of the front seat. So I went down a road that was closed, which I didn't know until I came. It'd be the equivalent of if they were working on Interstate 40 and you were on the other side of the barrels. So it's like major trouble. It's a big fine if you hit a barrel, let alone drive on the side of the road the construction workers are working on. So I pull up. Thankfully, I did have a suit on because I was preaching that night, and I had rented a Mercedes. So I at least looked like I was smart. So I pull up, and these construction workers are looking at me, and there's a couple guys that are in charge, whether they were law enforcement or what, and they're looking at me like, "Who is this idiot? We're going to fine, arrest, what?" You could tell. So I knew what to do. I figured I'm going to give it a shot. I pulled up real slow. I didn't stop the car, and I rolled the window down, and I went, "How's the project going, gentlemen?" They kind of were taking it. They said, "Good." I said, "Do you think you'll be done on time?" They said, "Yeah, we think we can finish on time." I said, "Well, if you need a couple extra weeks, it's fine. You guys are doing a good job." And they shook their head and said, "Thanks." And I quickly backed down and went on the other side of the road. It's called making up your mind and determination. Now, let me tell you one that has to do with salvation. I made up my mind as a little boy. I'm going to hell. I heard my dad preach on heaven and hell. I made up my mind. I'm not going to hell. I gave my life to Jesus. The Lord sent one of his messengers to visit me in my room that night I told you about. And that did something for me because I know there's that other realm that I'm going to give an account to one time. That's when it really takes all the fear out of you about anything here. And so I was in high school and I won a talent contest they had. I wrote a song about the janitor of the school, and we sang it together, and it made everybody laugh. So as soon as I get done and I won that contest, it was a whole school assembly. This kid that was real popular came up to me, never talked to me before. And he goes, "Hey, that was really funny." I said, "Thanks." He said, we're having a big party this weekend. He said, I wanted to invite you, and I'm going to tell you where it's at. And then as he was inviting me, he went, you're a Christian, aren't you? I said, yeah. He went, you could come, but don't come. You won't have a good time. You should keep doing what you're doing, man. Like that. Well, you know, what did that unsaved kid feel on me? That I got it simultaneously invited and disinvited to a party. I didn't even get a chance to say, no, I don't come. He handled his own temptation for me. What if the Lord tonight put something on your life where even heathen people knew you don't touch her? You don't touch him. He's different. Where the devil that was assigned to tempt you lost its nerve halfway through the temptation. Because you're so sold out to God, you're known as a Jesus man. Like Paul said, I, Paul, a slave of Christ. I am God's man. I live in this world to preach. I'm not of this world. I don't care what's popular in this world. I am here on a mission from God. And I'm not backing out for anything. What about you? I don't know you, but you know you. Are you one of those people they have to track down for church? I'm going through kind of a hard time. You're not going through a hard time. You're lukewarm. Because when you keep that fire lit, hard times stay away. They might try to set up shop, but they can't set up shop because there's something on the inside of you that's greater than everything that's in this world. The fire must never go out. There's many people, if you were honest, you're not cold, but you're lukewarm. I battle depression. I'm telling you, it's not a battle with depression. It's fire. You don't get full of the Holy Ghost and battle. That fire burns up every unclean thing, and it'll do it tonight. Say it out loud. The fire must never go out. Now say it more personally. Say, my fire will never go out. Somebody say it in Spanish loud. My fire will never go out. Say it one more time. Third time. I'm not waiting to serve God seriously till I'm 70. Doing it now. I'm not going to be a man of God when I'm 75. I'm going to do it now at 41. I'm giving God my best years. I'm giving God my now. I'm giving him my high school years. I'm giving him my college years. I'm giving him my young adult years. I'm not giving my life to Jesus on my deathbed. I'm giving him my life with my shoes on. And if I was here and I was somebody that used to be in drugs before tonight or gangs or whatever else, I'd make up my mind. Not only am I going to be on fire for God, I'm going to make the devil sorry he didn't take me out when he had the chance. I'm going to go into his camp and mess it up from now until when Jesus comes. That's going to be you. I said, that's going to be you. You're not going to see hell. You're going to make heaven. Your family's going to make heaven. Looking straight up at me. If you're here and you say, Jonathan, I can't honestly say I'm hot. I can't honestly say my fire is burning and bright. I've allowed the coldness of this world, whether it took the shape of drugs or alcohol or uncontrolled anger or lust or perversion, I've allowed something in that has deadened my fire. But I make up my mind tonight, I'm going to lay my life down on this altar. Pick up my cross and receive the fire of the Holy Ghost, and I'm never turning back. And I'm not putting it off 1 hour. Tonight, I make up my mind. I'm going to serve the Lord with all my heart. I want you to quickly come out of your seat and join me at this altar. We're going to pray right now. Come right now. Come right now. Don't put it off 1 minute. This is your hour. The devil's not going to have you. The fire's never going to go out. Come. Anybody that the Lord's dealing with your heart, come. We're going to pray. We're going to pray. Devil's not going to have your marriage. Devil's not going to have your children. Enough is enough. Keep coming. God's dealing with your heart. Come now. Keep coming. This is your night. Devil's not going to have you. Anybody else before we pray?
You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory.
Every hand lifted to the Lord. Say this out loud from the bottom of your heart. Those that are in your seats, press your hands forward from your seats and begin to intercede for those that are at the altar. Say this out loud and say it loudly. Father, tonight I give you my life. All of my life. Everything I am is now yours. I believe in my heart you raised Jesus from the dead. I confess with my mouth Jesus is Lord and my Savior. I turn my back on sin. I say yes to Jesus. Give me power in my spirit to never turn back, to never take one backward step. In Jesus' name. Now with your hands lifted, just begin to thank him out of your mouth that he's done it. The Lord's touching you right now at this altar. You're never going to cut yourself again. You're never going to battle anxiety again. Everything that's of the enemy departs from your life now. It loses its hold on you. My friend, come right up with me. Power of God's all over you. That's the power of the Lord. Lift both hands to the Lord. Right now, Jesus is setting you free. What the devil tried to wrap around your life, the Lord unwraps it right now.
Be
lift your hands all across the front. Now, if you sleep with people you're not married to, nobody will care. No one cares. But God cares. It produces kids with a half-committed dad or a no-committed dad. And the cycle continues. You may have come from a broken home, but a broken home will not come from you. You make up your mind that from tonight, I'm going to live according to the precepts of God's word. South Koreans and Jews, lowest rate of fatherlessness, lowest rate of incarcerated people in their ethnicity. And then you go to highest rate of fatherlessness, highest rate of incarceration. Before sin, God created the family. Father, mother, raising the children in the fear and admonition of the Lord. To destroy a nation, God knows, the devil knows he has to start with the family. That's why all these doctrines come in. Family's whatever you want it to be. Do whatever you want with your body. That's the devil talking to break down the family. Make up your mind when you leave this altar. Your body's not for sale. Your body's not a favor to be passed around at parties. Your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. All the men that are at this altar, say, I am a man of God. Somebody tell me in the crowd how you say, I'm a man of God in Spanish. That sounds even better. Hombre de Dios. Well, I'm not promoting tattoos, but if I was, that'd make a pretty good tattoo. Hombre de Dios. I'm God's man. I'm a man of God. All the women that are at the altar, say, I'm a woman of God. Yeah. It's living right. It's living according to God's word now. I'm not trying to give depressing news at all, but just facts. Every person, when you leave this altar, you'll have an opportunity to turn back on the decision you made. Some of you might have a text message waiting for you right now on your phone from a friend you had from before tonight. Hey, later tonight, we're doing this, this, and this. You make up your mind now at the altar. Those days are over. O-V-A-H. Over. Who I used to be is not who I am now. I'm born again. From tonight, your marriage will heal. From tonight, your relationship with your children will heal. God will restore everything the enemy damaged. Amen.